In this session, we are going to see an introduction to sourcing and procurement in S/4HANA. So, we are going to see the big picture of what includes sourcing and procurement in S/4HANA, and we are going to introduce the main concepts and basically the process flow. This topic will be explained further in next lectures. So, first of all, when we talk about the sourcing and procurement process, we could say that the process starts with the contract management, where there's going to be some sourcing negotiations with our vendors for getting the prices and the different options that we have to buy the materials that we need for our organization. Then when we start our processes, we are going to have the material requirements planning, where we are going to explode down our bill of materials in order to know what we need to buy and at what time. This will be with the materials requirements planning. It could be possible that some buys, that there's going to be some materials that are not going to be bought based on the requirements planning, because they might be used for maintenance or for other purposes, and they are not productive materials. Push requisitions, once we run the MRP, or it would be also possible to create manually push requisitions if we want to start the process of buying a quantity of a material. Then these purchase requisitions are going to be converted into purchase orders, and this is going to be what we send to our vendors in order to procure what we need from them. Then we are going to receive these quantities. If they are services, we can receive as well the confirmation. We can make the confirmation of the service, but normally if they are materials, we are going to make the receipt of these materials in our plant in order to enter them into our stock. And finally, once the receipt has been done, we are going to start the invoice management process, where we are going to enter into the system the invoice from the vendor, and we are going to start the process of paying them. That is going to be a financial process. On the other hand, and in parallel, we are going to have the supplier management into S/4HANA, where we can evaluate and report the different activities of our vendors in order to manage them in the best place, in the best way, trying to optimize our relationships with them. Organizational structure, the main thing that we have to remember is that there's going to be different data in SAP. First of all, we have the organizational structure that is going to be how we organize all the rest of the data. And here, for instance, we are going to have the client, company code, the plant. So these are going to be very stable data that is going to be set up once we start the implementation, once we do the implementation of S/4HANA, and that they might change in the future, but there's not going to be many changes to them. Then we have another level that are going to be master data. This is a quite stable data, like materials, vendor, customers, that are going to be used in the next data, the transactional data, but that we are going to maintain, and they might be reused in different of them. And then we have the transactional data, that is the day-to-day data that we use in our organizations, like purchase orders, production orders, sales orders, that this transactional data is going to use master data, and this master data at the end is going to be created inside an organizational structure. So we need to define for which structure in our organization we are going to create master data and transactional data. This is important for understanding the rest of the concepts. And then we are going to talk about the operations main organizational structure. So first of all, we have a client that is going to be is going to cover all the data that we have in our implementation, and where we can have different one or different company codes. Company code is the organization for which we need to create external reporting to the main authorizations. For instance, for each country, we might need a different company code because we need to report our statements to and taxes to the authorizations to this country. Below the company code, we can have different plans, and below each plan, we can have different store locations. So each plan is going to be each location where we are going to make some activities. For instance, a factory or a distribution center or only maybe offices, but they are going to be located in different places and they are going to have different data that is going to be specific of these plants. At the same time, below each plant, we are going to have different store locations where we can manage stocks. This will be with the functionality inventory management, but it's also possible to use warehouse numbers when we use EWM. So if we use WM or EWM, we could have a different structure here that is going to be a warehouse number, but this could be only one store allocation managed with warehouse number, or more than one, even from different plants, could be included inside a warehouse number. At the end, the warehouse number, what is going to allow is to manage in bins or in different locations, the different materials that we enter into our storage locations. We can have, as we said, different plants inside the different company code, and we can have, as we said, different company codes in the same client with their own plant or plants and with their own storage locations. So this would be the main elements of our operations organizational structure. And now inside the purchasing, of course, we are going to take into account the data for company code in order to define the taxes that we need that we need to declare into the system. We need to have the different plants in order to know for which of these different plants we are buying, we are procuring, and the store allocations in case we need to enter into stock. We need to tell the system in which specific store allocation we are receiving the quantities from our vendors. But at the same time, we can have a purchasing organization that could include all of the different plants, could include only different plants of the same company code, or even we can have different purchase organization for each plant. The purchase organization at the end is going to centralize all the purchasing decisions, like could be prices or delivery times, etc. So this would be a different structure and a specific structure of or element of purchasing in which we can include different plants. And finally, we have master data. We are going to have master data and transactional data, and the main master data we are going to have in purchasing is going to be the materials. Of course, we need to tell the system which material we are going to procure, and the vendor, we need to tell the system from which vendor we are going to procure them. And there is another master data object, that is purchasing info record, where we are going to store different information from material and vendor. For instance, we could have one material that can be procured from different vendors, and we can have different purchasing info records for this material and these different vendors, where we can have different prices, for instance, or delivery times or lead times. And all of this information is going to be used in the transactional data. In this case, the main transactional data for sourcing and procurement is going to be the purchase order.